Now, the people who actually tried to find out the essential characteristics, very difficult to explain at this level now, but you have actually situation in trying to find out the strain and other stress. See, we are already plotting the more plots now, more plots of stress. You can also plot more plots of strain also. So, if you try to plot these things now, what is it important for us is that this horizon region is actually meant for tension actually, and the vertical region is for compression. That is what they try to say. The principal compression is coming in the direction now, the principal tension is coming in the direction. So, fundamentally, we are placing horizontal because that strain is coming. Particularly in the basal infrastructure, you are going to find that this becomes the most best way of doing it. But then if you are coming in this zone now, this reinforcement needs to be vertical now. So, depending upon the structure we are going to think of, there will be these zones of compression and extension. And obviously, with extending, that is where you want to prevent now. And compression, naturally, the soil is good in compression. Okay, that is the concept now. So, I am not explaining now, but zones will give you three different pictures. You can study them very easily. Just pick up one of them now. They also explained very well by him by what we call as a coin ladder wall. So, in this case, he picks up a drawing of a Hove beam. Okay, in this beam now, whatever is shown in red, of course, is the tension member. Here it is obviously, at the bottom there is a tension member. At the top, there is going to be compression. So, all the things, the inclined member here now and the top one are all in compression when the shape is like this now. So, for our consideration now, he just breaks into two portions now, turns it 90 degrees and places on horizontally. Just 90 degrees turned out, place it horizontally, the edge portion now. So, this is the picture we are going to get now. In this picture, the full lines, the full red lines are having the highest tensile stresses. And the dotted red lines are having lesser tension, okay. And the black ones are compression, and these dotted ones, because black ones are more compression, and the dotted ones are less compression. So, he opines, now this concept changes now, but fundamentally, he opines that we are anyway having concrete fascia. Today we are having structures wherein concrete fascia is not there, but anyway, so this we have to take it at a pinch of salt, but it was those days now. So, when we said definitely had a concrete fascia, and in the concrete fascia, naturally, it is able to take a compression stresses. Soil anyway is good for compression and a bit of tension. And then, of course, this is essentially the geosynthetic reinforcement you are going to provide now. So, another concept you develop now. This concept actually, this was developed in 1924, before this kind of structures have come into being. But then, people are, I will come to this figure again. Before this was done actually, the people who are working on in that time, between 20 to 30s probably, they were working on this now. So, this is what I like. In 29 now, there is a French patent. It is called coin wall actually. So, what is it you find in this? This is 29 patent. You see this figure taken from the patent only. What is there now? First of all, from our soil mechanics viewpoint, this is a selected stone fill. Today we talk of a granular fill between the reinforcements. So, they have already said selected stone fill. This is fill which is giving the earth pressure anyway, ordinary fill. And then this reinforcement now is a tie with an anchor. Some companies actually use this anchorage very well. It was very popular in Japan also earlier. Then we have these fascia elements now. What are the fascia elements? The fascia elements are precast concrete facing units. Size will be 1.5 by 0.8 meters. Now, another interesting point is that they didn't place one or other one now, because they knew too well that soil will be compressible, and as you compact higher and higher now, the bottom portions are like definitely likely to settle. This is known by elastic settlement itself, it will settle anyway, it's a granular material anyway, it is going to settle instantaneously. So, when the soil is settling, the panels will try to settle, and if you are not allowing to settle, naturally, the panel will remain the same and the connection here will remain the same, and the soil coming down means it is going to have a pull-out effect on the panel. Conceptually, that is what is thought. So, what they did was simply allowed the panel to move. So, they said they are not going to place the top panel or the bottom one, they simply displace it by the thickness of the, that's it. So, it can move if it wants. So, what a beautiful concept they had in 1929 patent now. So, then just before that, around that period, there were another patent in the US wherein similar arrangement now. What did they have? They have actually ladder kind of arrangement for reinforcement now. The concept of geogrid was there in those days. Earlier it was only a tie rod actually with an anchor now. Now it is a ladder kind of arrangement. And then the ladder was not placed horizontally, it placed a little bit of inclination. In fact, today we have nailing done with inclination. And then what is it which is done is now the fascia, these panels, I mean these reinforcement panels, I mean reinforcement ladders can move vertically down because not connected rigidly. Suppose you see the plan view of this now, you see it's like a channel section now, the reinforcement can move vertically down now. Earlier we thought that that way he displaced the panels, fascia panels now. Here he is allowing the panel to be fixed actually and then allowing the reinforcement to move. Because it realized as early as 1930 that this connection or this way which we are going to arrange is going to be very critical actually. So that is the beauty of the structure. So then of course based upon this concept in as early as 1963, Henry was an architect actually, he created a system and in the system it was actually steel. Okay, so we can say corrugated thin sheets were there and then they had a, you can say rigid steel members as a reinforcement to take care of tension. And then it was supposed to granular fill. But over the period of time, the question of corrosion has come into picture. It was initially done, 1,000 structures are done in 45 countries actually, very successfully. But what happened was that the material, the corrugated steel was getting obviously corroded, it was bad appearance. So finally they resolved to develop a new system wherein we have a precast concrete fascia and then we have ribbed steel strips and then a connection also was appropriately designed. Dr. Thomas is going to talk more about this. But point I am trying to tell is that even in those days also, it is not simply a panel wherein connection is made now. You see this shape of this, there is a tongue and groove kind of joint or lip joint is there. And then where necessary they also had shared members now. So there is a way in which they were designed. It's not simply a concrete panel, fascia panel of any shape and then any kind of reinforcement. It was a designed system actually in which there are several components on this now. Simultaneously, the Transportation Research Laboratory at Crathorne have developed a system called York method. So you see this interestingly for us now. There are these rods, vertical rods, reinforcement can now easily move freely, there is no control on that now and he developed a fascia which is kind of three dimensional. The earlier patent was French patent, this was obviously a British patent. There was a lot of tug of war between the two countries, finally the Britain has to pay royalty to them because it is technology, because the patent was so thorough basically the French patent, so it never became common. They found that having the other systems is better now and that led to the advent of geosynthetics obviously, because whenever companies try to patent very heavily now, always competitor will try to develop another system to meet this now. So basically geosynthetics came into use of this. It's not that it's not successful, it's the most successful structure today also, in the country also. In fact, they keep working. Okay, today the company which is called Terry Army is owned by Fresenet, Fresenet who brought in the precast concrete technology, everything else. Okay, so that is something which is there anyway. So we have this. So other kind of systems which are there in vogue since quite some time was this anchorage. These multiple anchors were supposed to be very good in taking care of the earthquake resistance also. Very common. In fact, till 20 years back, we had a lot of papers from Japan coming out on this. Today they have also responsibility because they have a better quality juices which are there. The only two other points I want to make before I close for today is that we are not looking at a simple wall. We are also looking at a bridge abutment wherein the bridge deck slab is directly placed on the wall now. So to think that it is an approach, you know, all the flavors are having will be approach the bridge only. The deck slab is resting on another separate pier, another foundation, everything is there. But today, in fact, I understood just a few days before only that quite a few work which is done by Terry Army today in the country itself is going to be what now we call as integrated bridge. Integrated bridge really means that the deck slab is resting on the reinforced soil system. Okay, so then we can have reinforcements not necessarily exactly same. We can have reinforcements longer here at the bottom and shorter at the top or vice versa. This is a design element basically. It depends upon the kind of are you doing to in rocky area something like that now. So all this will be dealt with by Dr. Jimmy, so I am skipping that now. It can be waterfront structure also. Okay, so there are many possibilities of using this, including a NOS barrier. So these are all what we call as types of walls and abutments. And then we can also have different kind of systems also. So what we were thinking is earlier, we were thinking of essentially a wall and then integrated bridge kind of thing, abut bridge abutment. And then we can have a steep slope, we can have a flatter slope to reinstate landslide area now. We can also push the rods, let us say, into the soil when it's going to be cut now, and that is called soil nailing, a subject by itself. And then when the soil is soft at the bottom now, you want to construct embankment, then we have basal reinforcement now. It can be a not only single or multiple reinforcement, it can be a mattress. And in many cases, there are caverns also, like limestone caverns. So even to cover up that also, you can have this kind of thing. And one more thing, of course, is that we can have geostructural surfaced piles basically to reduce, in order to reduce the pile cap size. They distribute the load over the cap very eminently. So that is a subject by itself now. So it's called pile embankment with the basal reinforcement. That means this and this is combined together now. But here I wanted to stop thinking and then look at this figure now. This looks like a kind of godown, large area. And we can place a reinforcement here now. So all along, what we are trying to say? We're trying to say that the strength is improving, the bearing capacity is like to improve, many things like that we are stating. But here, the British code says clearly, there is not yet enough experience with this application to be included in a code of practice. What do you mean by this now? Everybody, you know, when we lecture, they say that, sir, we'll have to place our lower building now. So for a foundation design, what are the two components, Naman? What are the two components for which you design in a foundation? Bearing capacity and settlement. Now, what are we talking? Did I ever talk of settlement now? No, we never talked of settlement. We talk of immediate settlement at best, but we didn't talk of settlement in a clay soil. So, whatever we are trying to look at is only bearing capacity improvement. If you want to improve the settlement characteristics, there are other methods which are there, like stone comes there, PVDs, we will come to those things now. So, this topic we are considering essentially meant for improving, considering a new retaining systems, two load bearing systems now, they will not consider the settlement aspect. Sometimes it's better, but definitely it not, because ultimately the load is going to come on the soil only. Whatever way you are going to place structure now, the load is going to come on the mother earth, and so it will settle differently. So that is why they don't include in this particular code of practice. So then, lastly, what we'll see is that we'll see that there is a wall which can be having vertical fascia, it can be slightly steep also, but then can be inclined. So these two are different systems now, which Dr. Jimmy will cover in a separate lecture only. The point is that we have to cut off walls only, I have shown you, but there will be slopes also. There are a lot of change differences, and we will find later that the slopes are going to be more economical, though they may take slightly more space now. He will illustrate very clearly to you. Then one thing we have to understand is that we are looking at a new concept in a wall or a slope. So in this wall now, we considered the earth pressures, we consider K0 and Ka. Okay? So depending upon the kind of structure and the ways constructed, we come to settlement of where and when to use Ka and K0. Very simple. But for K0 now, for Ka requires some movement now. Unless, you know, if you see the fundamentals of our active earth pressure now, the side of the wall actually is going to translate or rotate this to the base. Then only the Ka condition is going to mobilize. There's minimum pressure actually. So that's what we find. For reinforcement soil to work now, the soil and reinforcement must strain. Some strain is required. So this is what it means is that in a stable structure, the strain in the soil and reinforcement are equal. There is strain compatibility. This is the most important for us now. If any chance there is no compatibility, what is going to happen now? It will feel like a pack of cards. So that is something we have to remember. The strain reinforcement is influenced, of course, by the stiffness of the reinforcement. The soil properties, density and things like that, assess the state of the soil, how you are compacting, how it is going to maintain. All of them are going to be important in developing a strain system now. So when you try to look at that now, so this is again, I put in a different word. A basic property of reinforced soil is that some strain must occur before the soil and the reinforcement can interact. Then only it is going to be done. So all infrastructures move. They have to move. First is, we said, compatibility. But unless you move now, the pressure is not going to mobilize. After all, we said friction now. So there is static friction. There is something that happens when it is moving. So all reinforced structures move or strain during construction and construction techniques reflect this flexibility. We'll talk on this. Mr. Shankaravan is going to talk, and maybe I'll ask something later. So the construction techniques originally conceived actually are to take care of this particular aspect now. So the material could be stiff, but yet it has to move slightly. Material could be soft, it will move more, but it has to strain. To say that this wall is going to be exactly like a retained concrete, reinforced concrete wall, is a myth. It will have to move. But how much movement? It depends upon the system I have mentioned now. This is something we have to think of. So then the elements, of course, we will discuss later. Soil, reinforcement, facing. I will only have one slide to show you what is reinforcement element in our cases now. This is also classic work. Some of us can do this work also again. This picture tells you actually what kind of reinforcement we should have it now. In this case, as discussed, is only steel. To illustrate, to remove one point now. So one can be simply, we have a strip here and all bars are there, like tar steel bars are there. So another case, there are strips. Okay, you flatten the same area now. Area is same only. And the other case, we have the ladder kind of arrangement. We have a grid kind of arrangement now. So lot of tests have been done actually on one kind of sand and 70 kPa overburden pressure now. So you find out that the peak pullout, you put in a tank, this is put in a tank, pullout tank, let we'll call it now. Half of it is filled with sand and places reinforcement, and then over that you place another sand and then apply vertical normal stress over that, pull it out now. So that's called pullout force. So pullout force in the case of mesh or grid, we call it today, is 167 kilonewtons now. In the case of bar, is least 15. In the case of strips, 30. Mind you, this is steel strip. I mean, smooth steel strip. Okay, now supposing you don't make it steep, you make it ribbed, projections. Naturally, it will be more now. So that is what technology does. It does small gimmicks now. After all, we got full capacity. So either you put in terms of a mesh like this or grid like this, or change the system such a way that you get. Suppose instead of a plain rod, you can have a twisted rod. Or still you can have it. So like this, improvements will keep happening today. And we are using the mesh for gabions as reinforcement also. Whatever is cheaper, it depends on the relative cost of the steel and the synthetic mind, again, grid or geotextile. This is what we have to see. So the compared performance, of course, is in this case, compared to area now, the efficiency is so high. It is 1.67, 0.22, 0.29, negligible actually. So most important for us is going to be the grid structure. That is where you find most of the walls we are going to discuss will be in terms of grids or in terms of special strips. Very rarely in rods. Now in rods, how do you overcome this now? Or a strip, one way of overcoming this, we said, projections, let us say, the top and bottom. Now. Another way could be, have additional reinforcement in terms of anchorage at the end now. So these are engineering gimmicks basically. So you can design a system, develop a new system to get the maximum efficiency out of a form of reinforcement. Basic principles are going to be same. There is no difference in pain. And one thing is, we are playing between K and K naught now. The construction we set now, the kind of loadings we are going to have, the kind of earthquakes we are thinking of, the kind of foundation soil we have got, the kind of retained soil we have got, all of them are going to change the situation now. But these fundamentals which I mentioned are going to be same. Lastly, of course, we should remember that whatever was shown in terms of triaxial and things like that were illustrative, showing high value of friction, apparent friction, and high value of cohesion. These are not used in design because the actual spacing is going to be much larger. This is only few millimeters ultimately. So when it's a kind of micro reinforcement. Okay, where we are having the field is kind of macro now. Like macroeconomy now. What happens to a poor man and what happens to a bank? These are two different things actually. Same way here also, we find that we will not use these input parameters. But then what happens is that the presence of the geosynthetic increasing the shear parameters is not utilized in the structural design. But then that remains as an additional factor of safety which you didn't consider. That is one reason possibly that the structures have always been safe. Unless you did some careless work or something like that, we find that this becomes an additional factor of safety. So we are able to get more confidence by saying that it's going to work better because of this, though I didn't consider the increased value of C or phi in the actual design now. Okay? So don't think that I'll do some laboratory test and show that structure is going to be behaving like this. No. Whatever Dr. Jimmy Thomas is going to say will be separate. He will consider the basic properties of the soil, basic properties of the reinforcement, basic properties of the fascia, and also basic properties of the connection, and ultimately the drainage and other systems which are going to be add on to the overall system. So we will consider from the next lecture onwards as the rainfall soil geosystems actually. Okay. Any doubts you got on this? Please recap your...
I have one.
Yeah, please.
In Hausmann model, so initial there is only increase of correction angle and later several cohesion angles. So is it to do with any like slippage and drag?
No, no, I don't agree. We don't agree with that concept of Hausmann. We agree with the concept of bilinear kind of thing only, because in the most tests which our students have done, we find this bilinear.
Slipping is happening.
No, we can't say that, because you know this is in a pull-out test model. We can show this smaller length it will slip, and then longer length it will do that. In fact, that is what happened when we did work with Netlon. That is why we are able to show this model also. See, in when the beginning, in the let us say late 80s and early 90s, now we didn't have the geosynthetics which are having today. Neither they are manufactured nor they are imported. We had only small samples, but we had the nets made by Netlon at Baroda. They continue to make them same thing. So these are very weak materials, up to only strength will be of order of 5 to 7 kilonewton-meter, whereas we are talking of hundreds of kilonewtons today. So when you put this and try to conduct a pull-out test, we find that smaller length, you know, it is simply slip. Full length of the tank, you know, the tank was not so big, it was hardly 60 or 70, 80, 80 centimeters now. Finally, we find that half it is coming out, half is remaining there only. It is simply failing actually. So we are able to understand that better. But that's only a model study basically. So this critical confirmation, nothing to do with the real slip earlier this one. I strongly believe that. Other people have developed a lot of models now. But for all the work done by our students over many years now, we found this working very well. It simplifies understanding. It simplifies beyond some level of confining pressure. It is going to act as though only apparent cohesion is there. And below the confining pressure, the apparent increase in phi only is there. Nothing more than that. It just gives you an understanding. And the only point is that I do not want to say that this line is parallel to the normal phi line. It's not parallel. It's never simply parallel. So to defend that only, I gave this model. I followed the Hausmann model, which I found to be true in all cases. And that's why you said our people have worked up to 64 kilometers square also. So in another case also is valid. From very low, I have shown you 25 kilopascals only. We have done up to 6400 or maybe more than that also. It's difficult to do it, but we have the apparatus in IIT, so we have students have done it. You see, they very easy to do this. The point is that we are getting confidence in this. You see, when we are increasing the confirmation to such high values, what's going to happen? There's no increase. There's literally no increase in strength, no change in C and R. Because the soil is already so stiff, so dense, by once you apply the confirmation itself, so it becomes very, very dense. So by introducing material, probably which is even weaker than the soil, we are not going to benefit now. This is exactly true in our payments also. This concept we follow in payments. Suppose that we want to improve subgrade now, we put slightly better kind of grid. When you improve the, want to improve the bitumen layer, we have to put very strong material like a glass grid. You can't put a non-oven geotextile at the surface. So this concept we are using effectively, but all of them comes from these fundamentals, both for payments and reinforcement. Only thing is, there is no difference between these two, except that one is cyclic load. Okay. So that is why I said this has to very clear in your mind how and why is working. So you can always do some tests in the laboratory to show for yourself what is the truth. No? In fact, I urge the students to do some tests with the dry sand itself. Dry sand is easy to work with because the dry sand and the saturated sand have got same angle of friction anyway. So work with dry sand and paper. You can make a small model like he's going to tell you, a small model with a wraparound kind of wall also you can make in the laboratory. What our students have done initially to learn. Because, you know, in the beginning, we never believed that this works, actually, to be very frank. In the late 80s, when this, they were showing a lot of pictures to us all around the world, but we couldn't believe it that this works like this. Today, confidently, walls are being built with a near vertical facing up to 35 meters. Slopes are being built 80, 90 meters. Tired walls, of course, have been built up to 45 meters. I think the one at Kannur now, they say is 80 meters. 90, but there's a tire. So you see this, but there is a geo grid and a tire. So we can't Now, can you imagine that if you got a 90 meter wall, what is the foundation width size going to be? Impossible. The kind of loads are going to give on the foundation something. So, he will show you actually, I don't want to preempt him actually. The point is that it is a different kind of wonderful feeling also when you design that such structures can be designed and are being constructed in the country. Essentially also utilizing material which is made in the country. It is not necessary that we to import them. Depending upon overall, this one you can do it, but they are being made in the country. They are being made in Gujarat. Why forget in the country? They are being made in Gujarat. Some of it in our industrial areas, or you have to go to Vapi. It's not real Gujarat, the Daman Dayu and all, which is borderline to us. Okay? Thank you then. Right.